You know, in life, you never know when you're going to have one of those moments of clarity where all of a sudden you realize something that is really pretty obvious, but it never really occurred to you before. I mean, for me, it happened about 2 years ago. My mom had just passed away, and it was up to me and my sister to prepare her house to sell. And that meant we had to get rid of everything in the house. Every last thing had to be either donated or thrown out. And the hardest room for me to clean out was my old bedroom. Because in my bedroom was my closet. And in my closet, my mom had stored my entire life from age 0 till about 20. And I took everything out of the closet and I spread it all over the floor. And there were old art projects and comic books and records, and winter coats, and buttons, and all this irreplaceable junk. And I'm trying to figure out what to do with it. I'm trying to figure out, do I sort it? Do I just box it up and bring it home? Or maybe I should box up some of it and throw some of it out. But then you have to decide what you're going to keep and what you're going to throw. And I'm kind of trying to figure out what to do. And all of a sudden, I had this moment of clarity. And that moment of clarity was, I could imagine myself boxing it all up, bringing it home, storing it, only for my kids to find it one day after I'm gone, and they would pitch it. So I did the only thing I could do. I took out my phone, and I took a few pictures, and then I threw it all out. I kept the memories, but I lost the junk. And that was the beginning of a process for me, and that's what I want to talk to you about tonight. I know some of us here have a lot of stuff. If that's the case for you, then this message is for you. If you are a person who doesn't have a lot of stuff, maybe you're still in college or you just don't have a lot of stuff, then this message is definitely for you. Because I want to get you thinking biblically about possessions before you do what a lot of people do, and that is enter into a pattern of consumption and accumulation until all that stuff starts to work against you. We're going to talk about not just simplifying our possessions. We're going to talk about freedom and why it's a good idea to have less stuff. I like to take this topic tonight in three parts. And my goal is to show you sort of a biblical perspective on stuff, okay? So the first part is simply this. What's the problem with having a lot of stuff? Our culture kind of trains us to accumulate, you know? Our culture trains us to go to the mall and buy stuff. And there's a lot of stuff available, and it's all on sale, and everything's a good deal, and we tend to have a lot of stuff. What is the problem with that? I'd like to show you three passages that will challenge that type of thinking. The first passage involves John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist's role, his job, was to prepare people for the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And so John the Baptist preached a very strong message about repentance, about turning from sin and turning to God. And one day he was preaching this message, and some religious elite came by. And John said, don't think that you are okay with God just because you were born Jewish, because that's what many believed at the time. He said, you need to repent. And they asked him, what does that mean to repent? What does that look like? And here's how John answered that question. And he answered them, whoever has two tunics is to share with him who has none, and whoever has food is to do likewise. The first words out of John's mouth when asked, what does it mean to truly repent, had to do with their stuff. He said, if you have two shirts, which is what a tunic is, if you have two shirts, then give one away. Okay, now just make a mental note of this passage, okay? We're going to move on. The next passage involves Jesus talking to a young man who is described as a rich young ruler. He was a moral person. He did things right. He would be admired and well off and have it all together. And he asked Jesus, he said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" That was his concern. He was moral, he was rich, but he feared death. So he asked Jesus, "What must I do?" And Jesus answered by repeating a few of the Ten Commandments, and the young man said, "Well, I've done those. Ever since I was a young boy, I've obeyed those commandments." And then Jesus talked about his stuff. He said this from Luke chapter 18. He said to him, "One thing you still lack, sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." Now, you would think Jesus would simply say, "The one thing you lack is me, come follow me." But Jesus didn't say that. He said, "First deal with your stuff and then come follow me." Why did he say that? Because the stuff was an obstacle. How do we know the stuff was an obstacle? Because the man walked away. He chose his stuff over Jesus. Now, often when this text is preached on, the preacher will add, and I agree with this to a point, he will add, "This is Jesus' instruction to this particular young man." It doesn't necessarily apply to everyone, only those whose hearts are attached to their stuff. Here's the reason I don't quite agree with that, is because in the 12th chapter of Luke, we find Jesus speaking to his disciples. And they're worried. And Jesus is helping them with worry. And he's saying, "Don't worry about what you will wear or what you will eat, for it gives the Father great pleasure to give you the kingdom." He's reassuring them. And after he says that, he adds this: "Sell your possessions and give to the needy." So John says it, Jesus says it to the rich young man, and then Jesus says it to his disciples. Basically, have less stuff. So why? Why do we keep seeing this in the Bible? What is the problem with having stuff? Tyler Durden had it right. Tyler Durden, of course, is Brad Pitt's character in The Fight Club, which is a really good movie, by the way. He said, "The stuff you own ends up owning you." He didn't think of that, though. Jesus said it first. Here's how Jesus says it: "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Now, what does that mean? It means this: when you have a lot of stuff, that stuff usually costs you money, okay? So you're invested financially in your stuff. And then you have to give your stuff time. You have to organize it and clean it and maintain it and store it and do, you know, you got to take care of your stuff, right? And the thing you invest yourself in, you give your heart to. That's just the nature of who we are as human beings. We give our hearts away to our stuff when we have a lot of it, especially when we have a lot of nice stuff. Now, what does it look like when we give our hearts away? Because it's easy for us to think, "Well, I have a lot of nice stuff, but it does not have my heart." It's easy to think that. How do we know if our heart has gone to our stuff? Well, Jesus shows us. There's a time when Jesus told a parable, a story. And in the parable, there is a man who invites others to a banquet. And this is a symbol of Jesus' invitation to us to enter into kingdom living, to enter into a life of not only loving Jesus and being loved by Jesus, but living for his purposes and serving him. It's the best life that this world has to offer. Here's the parable. Jesus speaking says this: "But he said to him, a man once gave a great banquet and invited many, And at the time for the banquet, he sent his servant to say to those who had been invited, "Come, for everything is now ready." This is a symbol for Jesus' invitation to us to enter into a new life. The parable goes on. But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said to him, "I have bought a field, and I must go out and see it. Please have me excused." And another said, "I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to examine them. Please have me excused." The first two reasons we see for refusing the invitation are possessions. See, this is how it works. The stuff gets our heart. And how does that play out? We say yes to the stuff and we say no to Jesus. The stuff that we own starts to own us. I'll give you an example from my life. A couple years ago, I bought a guitar. I play guitar. An acoustic guitar. A pretty nice one, a Martin acoustic guitar made of mahogany. It doesn't look that much different than that one. It's dark like that. And what I didn't know when I bought it was this guitar is fragile. No one told me. Okay? So I'm walking through the house with my guitar and I bang into a wall, because that's what you do. And the guitar cracks. Okay? This frustrates me. So I drive across town to the repair shop, I leave it there and I drive home, and I drive back a couple days later and I pick it up, I give the guy $225 to fix the guitar, and I'm mad. This happens 4 times. Okay, here's my question. When I'm driving to the repair shop, and I know I'm going to have to take out my credit card and pay for yet another repair, and I'm annoyed, and I'm frustrated. Do I own the guitar, or does the guitar own me? You see, every one of our possessions, to some extent, ends up owning us. Now, I understand you have to have some stuff. I have stuff. But it is wise to think carefully about not having too much of it, because it takes up more of us than we realize. And the more of us it takes up, the less available we are to pursue a life of following Jesus completely. We're bound. See, this is why I'm talking. This is about freedom. It's about being free from unnecessary ties to things. Okay, next part. Okay, what am I supposed to do with my stuff? Well, John said it simply. John said it like this, and he answered them, "Whoever has 2 tunics is to share with him who has none, and whoever has food is to do likewise." Now notice, John doesn't say, if you have 2 shirts, take one and throw it away, or take one and give it to your friend. He doesn't say that. He says, use this to benefit others in need. Give to the poor. Give to those who have none. And there is a principle here that's really important. You see, Jesus is in the business of redemption. When we put our faith in Jesus Christ, he redeems us. He remakes us. We are reborn. But it's not just that. Jesus is in the business of taking things that are dead and lifeless and useless and giving them life, giving them new purpose. Okay? And he can do that with your extra stuff. The stuff you have around your house that you don't really need, Jesus can redeem. How does that work? Let's look at another passage that explains it. From Luke 12, Jesus, speaking to his disciples here, says this, "Sell your possessions and give to the needy." Okay, just highlight, please, that first sentence. Sell your possessions and give to the needy. This is the first redemption, is the needs of others will be met. What was useless and unnecessary in your life can become something that fulfills a purpose in someone else's life. That's the first redemption. It goes on. Next part, please. Provide yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. What Jesus is saying here is when you take your excess, when you take your surplus and use it to bless someone who really needs it a lot more, God keeps track of that. And there is some sort of heavenly reward or heavenly treasure, which no one knows really what it is, but this is a motive that Jesus gives us to pursue these things. And it's a faith-based motive. We have to have faith because we won't see it in this life necessarily. It'll be in the next life. That's the second redemption. The third redemption is this: for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You get a new heart's desire. Now, there's a little principle about human beings there that I want you to notice. Is you give first, and then your heart follows, okay? Sometimes we'll feel like, well, I don't want to do this because I don't feel it. What we see here is we do it without feeling it, and the more we pursue this, the more our heart comes alongside and has a new passion and a new desire. The heart follows the action. That's what we see there. So, to sum up, the three redemptions we get when we do this is the needs of others are met, we earn treasures in heaven, and our heart changes and becomes more like the heart of Christ. All by giving away stuff that you really don't need. And we have a lot. I mean, when I first started doing this exercise, I went through my house looking for the duplicates. And one of the first things I discovered was I had three hammers. I had a hammer made in the early 60s that belonged to my dad. I had a hammer that was all metal that came with one of those junior tool kits someone gave me. And I had a regular hammer with a wooden thing. Three hammers. Do you know how many hammers I need? Zero. I had three. I now have one, and I don't need it. It's worth it. I don't miss those two hammers. They're just one more thing, making my toolkit, which I hardly need, all filled up and hard to find things, you know? It's just more stuff in there. Next part. What if I don't want to do this? What if I really don't want to do this? I know what it says in the verses. I know what it says, but I really don't want to do it. Here, I'm going to tell you why this is hard to do. It's because the way we're raised and our culture and the way the world is, you know, we believe that if we give away our excess stuff, it'll make our lives worse. And so we don't want to do it. That's the belief, okay? So we need to challenge that belief. First, I want to show you this verse. This is what Jesus says here. He says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly," okay? Jesus didn't come here to give you a bunch of rules to make your life worse. He came here to give you abundant life. Now, don't confuse that with easy life, because following Jesus won't always give you the easiest life, but following Jesus will give you the most abundant life. Okay? So, Jesus doesn't tell us to do these things to make our lives worse, but we feel that it'll make our lives worse, because stuff is supposed to make our lives better. Jesus speaks to that directly when he says this right here. "For one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." What Jesus is saying there is you and I and all of us have a desire for abundant living. We have a desire for an abundant life, okay? God put that desire into you. That's not a bad desire, it's a good desire. But the problem is we try to fulfill it with the wrong thing, with a cheap substitute. We try to fulfill that desire by going to the mall, by getting yet another good deal on something that maybe we don't need. But that's not where abundant life is. But the problem is, it's so hard to escape that kind of thinking. Excess stuff, I want to read you some statistics on excess stuff. A few things I got from a website that I'll tell you about later. Number one, the U.S. Department of Energy reports that 1/4 of people with 2-car garages have so much stuff in there they can't park a car in there at all. That's 25%. Can't get their car in the garage because they have too much in there. According to the National Soap and Detergent Association, it really does exist. You can look it up. The National Soap and Detergent. You may want to join. I don't know. Getting rid of clutter would eliminate 40% of housework in the average home. 40% of your housework gone if the clutter was gone. That's what they say. The National Association of Professional Organizers reports we spend 1 year of our lives looking for lost items. That's sad, man. If you rent a storage facility to store your excess belongings, you're contributing to a $154 billion industry bigger than the Hollywood film business. And then one more. 1 in 11 American households, 1 in 11, rent a self-storage space and spend over $1,000 a year in rent. 1 in 11. Spend $1,000 a year in rent. So wouldn't you say that, speaking generally, our culture has bought into the idea that more stuff creates a better life? But Jesus says life is not found in possessions. It's not there. How many times have you tried to satisfy yourself by buying a new shirt or a new pair of shoes or some new gear for your hobby, and it feels good for a day or two, and then you're kind of back to where you were? Doesn't work. I've done that. Doesn't work. Abundant living is found in knowing Jesus loves you, knowing Jesus enjoys you, and loving and enjoying Him and pursuing Him. But the stuff can hold you back from that. That's why it says in the book of Hebrews, this right here, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin, which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. In this passage, following Jesus is compared to a race. And Paul, who is probably the writer of Hebrews, says, don't run the race with weight on your back. You wouldn't run a marathon, but first pack a backpack full of bricks and put it on. But that's what stuff can do. You know, think of the parable that Jesus, about the banquet. Think of that parable. And people saying no to the invitation because things they owned were pulling them away. That's the weight that keeps us from running the race. And the race is where the abundant life is at. That's where it's at. That's the best life this world has to offer, is life with Jesus. But some of us need to get free from that. Or some of us need to make sure we stay free from that by not joining the pattern of consumption that our culture offers. I want to give you some things that have helped me. This, for me, so far has been a 2-year journey. And if you came to my house and looked around, you would see plenty of stuff. We're not like super Spartan and minimalist, but we have much less than we used to. And we kind of chip away at it for a few weeks, and we kind of forget about it for a few weeks. You know, it's kind of a process, okay? Here's the four things that have helped us the most. Number one, donate the duplicates. I discovered I had a lot of duplicates, and I didn't need that. And the one thing that slowed me down from donating the duplicates is the just-in-case impulse, which is really powerful. But for some reason, it's like, you know, I got three rakes here, but I just in case, you know? for some reason, just in case trumps every other argument, you know, at least emotionally. So look for the duplicates and consider if you really need those. Sometimes you do, you know, depending on your situation and the particulars, but sometimes you don't. So start there. Look for duplicates. And for clothing, the duplicate principle can work for clothing, you know. Instead of maybe someone has 12 pairs of jeans, you know. Well, maybe you'd be fine with just four pair. And you could find a new home and let God redeem those other jeans by meeting a need in someone else. Second one that's helped us is the 1 to 2 year rule. If there's things in your home that you haven't touched or used for 1 to 2 years, or clothing that you haven't worn for 1 to 2 years, then that would be something you should consider giving away. This really hit home for me a while back, where I was going through my closet and I had a pair of cowboy boots. And these are like nice cowboy, why is that hard to say? These were really nice Western boots. Felt good. But the thing is, I hadn't worn these for like 10 years. I mean, and you know why? I mean, if I showed up here tonight with cowboy boots on, what would you think? I bet someone has cowboy boots on and they're going to talk to me after the service. And I don't mean anything. They just aren't for me. And so they're gone. And someone was really happy to get them. I just know. The 1 to 2 year rule. Next is take photos. You know, I'm not against sentimental items. I have sentimental items, you know. But too many sentimental items can just bog you down. It's too much. And it's hard to get rid of stuff, you know, because once it's gone, it's not replaceable. It's gone forever. Take photos. That makes it a lot easier. I just take photos and take photos and take, and that makes it so I can get rid of useless old stuff. Remember, the memories aren't in the object. The memories aren't you. You'll still have the memories, even if you lose the stuff. And then lastly, remember, it's a process. It takes time to do this. You know, it doesn't happen overnight for most people. And if you're a married couple, you have to kind of be patient with each other, because this sermon has started more than one argument. And I don't want to start an argument. I really don't. But, you know, sometimes one will be like, you know, we're getting rid of everything, you know, and the other one's like, no, we're getting more stuff. And it's just, they're not even close. And you got to take your time. It's a process. And you got to kind of take it to the Lord and pray and say, Lord, you know, what do you want us to do here? Is this, do we need this? Do we not need this? You know, and be patient with each other and work as a team, you know, and make sure you keep that that love and harmony. You know? So, and then finally, there's a website I'd like to recommend if you are interested in just kind of learning more about this. I've looked at a ton of websites on minimalism and things like that. The one that is most helpful, in my opinion, is called Becoming Minimalist. Becoming Minimal... oh, no. BecomingMinimalist.com. It's written by Joshua Becker. He's a believer. He used to be a youth pastor over in Wisconsin. In fact, someone at the Bloomington location is a friend of his. And you know, vouches for the guy. not every little thing is something I would endorse. He doesn't really write it from a purely Christian perspective all the time. It's more for everyone. But it's a very helpful website if you're interested in practical tips and inspiration for pursuing this. So anyway, I just want to encourage you to think through this stuff. You know, another thing that really got my attention, I'll give you one more story, is my mom. Because my mom passed away with a liver disease, kidney disease. And I remember the doctor told her at one point she had two options. She could either enter into hospice, where she would have about a week, or he could keep her alive for a few more months, but she would be in the hospital the whole time. And my mom was like, I want to go see Jesus, so I'll go to hospice, which kind of blew the minds of a lot of the people around her. But I probably would have said the same thing, to be honest. So she was in hospice, so a hospice home over in Edina. And here she is in a strange bedroom with not much of her life left to live. And at one point I asked her, I said, Mom, would you like me to go to your house and get some of your, you know, your stuff, your photos or your music or, you know, all these things that, you know, mean a lot to you? Would you like me to go get these things and bring them here? And she said, no. She wasn't interested because she was looking forward. All she cared about was her family and seeing the Lord. And all the stuff that was so important to her all of a sudden wasn't important at all. See, she was seeing life really clearly at that point, I think. And I think one of the keys to living an effective life is to get to that place as soon as you can. So that's my hope for you. Let me pray. Dear Lord, Father, I just pray, Lord, that you use these words tonight, Lord, for your glory and for the encouragement of this church, Lord. Help us, Lord, to live lives for you, Lord. Help us to know that the abundant life comes from loving you and knowing that you love us, Father. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, if you have any questions or comments or you just want to say howdy, I'll hang out over here. Thanks, you guys. Bye.